Hey, Thrive Out listeners, Lou Diamond here, jumping in at the top of the show. We have a really special episode here with Amanda B. Johnson from Dash. You are really going to enjoy this conversation. If you've ever had any questions about what cryptocurrency, blockchain technology, bitcoins, tokens, anything of all of these buzzwords that are out there, Amanda B. Johnson of Dash does a wonderful job in this interview helping explain all about these buzzwords, new technologies, currencies, and how they came to be, where they are today, and where they could be heading. So if you ever wanted a really quick tutorial on everything you need to know about this space, Amanda does a great job doing it. You're going to enjoy this episode. I wanted to jump in and give that heads up. So stay tuned, listen all the way to the end. She does a great job, and thrive loud. This Thrive Loud episode is brought to you by Hinge Consulting. Success on Amazon hinges on well-executed strategies. Contact Hinge Consulting to learn about total Amazon channel management and to see if your business has what it takes to grow over 300% over the next 12 months. That's Hinge Consulting at hingeconsulting.co.
Today on Thrive Loud,
we have upwards of 1,500 different cryptocurrencies in existence right now. And you can buy things with almost none of them.
No, I'm getting really excited. Okay, this is the part where I'm going to get loud.
Holy crap, here we go.
I like telling stories.
I learn best through experiences.
Everything I do is because of everything I did.
Talk about having maximum impact while having a ton of fun.
When you can net through that, what you do leave behind for your listener will have more impact.
Wow, bring it on.
It's time to take an inside look at those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. Today on Thrive Loud, we bring you someone who has been providing cryptocurrency research and commentary since 2014. Her educational and opinion pieces have appeared in leading industrial publications such as Bitcoin Magazine, Finance Magnates, and Bitcoin.com. And having created the first YouTube series to receive funding from a decentralized autonomous organization, she's been called the world's first freelancer to be paid by blockchain technology, which we're going to talk about today. Since 2016, she has been the official spokesperson for Dash Digital Currency and was recently named one of the top 10 women in cryptocurrency by Core Magazine. Thrive Loud listeners, we are honored to have Amanda B. Johnson with us today. Amanda, how are you?
I'm fine. How are you, Lou?
So for the Thrive Loud listeners, I often joke about the fact that we always have fun technical issues. And what I'm also learning is that I have technical issues with people that deal with technology every single day. So I'm very glad to have her on because she's patient and very cool. And we finally figured out a way to capture this beginning of this interview. So I'm looking forward to hopefully no more technical headaches as we go through this conversation. How about you?
I guess I'll just stop my voodoo magic now and let us be sure.
So I wanted Amanda to be on Thrive Loud because this topic of both, obviously many of you have been hearing, whether in the news or you've been watching the markets, the activity that goes on with the value of Bitcoin, you keep hearing things about cryptocurrencies. And obviously across the technology landscape, blockchain technology is changing the way we are connecting across all these different mediums and the way that we're interacting with different companies. And there is no better person on here than to have one of the guru experts that can help us really understand, kind of paint the picture of it, but also help us understand where things are going and learn a little bit about her along the way. So Amanda, that's kind of where I wanted to start off with this. This is new stuff, and give us a little bit of history on how you got into this space, because I think that will be interesting in and of itself.
Sure. In early 2013, I think I first came across the word Bitcoin on a Facebook post, and I thought it just looked kind of maybe like an in-game, maybe like Dungeons and Dragons kind of currency or something.
True.
And so I just, you know, kept going. But a few months later, a friend of mine who works at the Foundation for an Economic Education, Jeffrey Tucker, reached out and asked me if I owned any of this stuff. And I said, no, of course not. And he said, you really should try it out. And so he asked me to get on Skype. And I got on Skype. I had no idea what that had to do with anything. And he asked me to install a wallet app, a cryptocurrency wallet app on my tablet. And he said, hold your tablet up to the screen. And I'm just wondering, what is, you know, this magic? And he says, all right, now take your tablet down and look at it. And unbeknownst to me, he had scanned my wallet's QR code while it was held up to the screen. And he had sent me some digital tokens and told me to try to find a way to buy myself a t-shirt with it, actually. And yes, and we can get to the feasibility or infeasibility of that with the various cryptocurrencies out there later on in the segment. But from there, I just began to teach myself. At this time, there were just beginning to be more approachable educational resources online in terms of how a cryptocurrency works, meaning how a blockchain works, really, right? Because a cryptocurrency runs on a blockchain.
Let's give the Thrive Lab listeners who aren't familiar with it, because they've been hearing all these words, give them a little bit of a 101 so that we can get them up to speed, and then we'll take it to the next level. How about that? So let's talk about blockchain technology first, just as you were about to jump into.
Sure, let's please. So blockchain is just a fancy, really cool sounding word for something that's much simpler. And that is a digital ledger. And when I say ledger, if you're not familiar with that word, a ledger, if we can imagine a sort of, you know, ancient ledger, it would be a piece of paper and it would record ownership of various things. So we could have a ledger that records sheep. Lou owns 5 sheep. Amanda owns 3 sheep. And if I buy or sell a sheep from Lou or vice versa, the ledger would be updated accordingly. And that's what's called double entry accounting, which is for any gain that one account has, another account must be equally debited. And so that's really what a blockchain is. It is a digital double entry accounted ledger. And so the reason that I guess we call the units that each of these blockchains traces, we call them cryptocurrencies, is actually, I don't know who coined that term. I don't think it's the most accurate term, because the word currency, that's a medium of exchange, right? And so we have upwards of 1,500 different cryptocurrencies in existence right now. And you can buy things with almost none of them. And so really it's a misnomer. A more accurate term would be, you know, tokens living on these various blockchains. And so, yeah, so that should bring you up to speed at this point. And then to finish off my bio, I began writing at various publications and actually hosting my own YouTube-based news shows about cryptocurrency between 2014 and 2016, because initially, most of us, myself included, assumed that Bitcoin would be the only player in the game henceforth and forever. But it was during these years that more cryptocurrencies started to come out, or more blockchain tokens, I should say, right? And it seemed that some of them offered pretty considerable improvements over Bitcoin. And so I went into the journalism and research space pretty much for my own benefit, in that I wanted to study how they differed one from another so I could know how to invest personally. And so in so doing, I came to be most taken with a particular crypto called Dash. And I asked their network for a job 2 years ago, and they hired me in a very interesting manner. We can talk about that later if you like. And that's what I've been doing ever since.
So this is great. And you've become sort of the blogging or written voice around digital currency and the space that's been in with it. Let's dive in a little bit to exactly the point that you were hitting on, that there are so many more cryptocurrencies popping up all over the place. And I couldn't name them all, and you just hit the number that's out there. What's the feasibility and the usability of where it is today, but where everyone is trying to get it to? Because that's actually, we're at that point where, you know, it's almost like you're building a medium, but we haven't quite, let's like, we're building the boat as we're going across the ocean. We haven't quite finished it yet. So I guess the question to you is, where is it today and where is it going to head to?
Sure. So there is no one general thrust. There is no one general goal. There are lots of different people with lots of different goals. And so what we're going to see in the years to come is whose goals the market really does demand and whose goals were just kind of pie in the sky and unstudied. And, you know, those tokens will eventually go to zero. Now, I believe, and owners of Dash in particular believe, that the first application of a blockchain has still yet to be reached. And that is the application that was spelled out specifically in the white paper by the person or persons who first invented Bitcoin. He or she or they have gone by the pseudonym of Satoshi Nakamoto. No one knows who this person is, but we have his white paper. And his white paper very clearly says that he was building a system to be used as digital cash. Now, for various reasons, Bitcoin has made itself completely unusable as a digital cash due to two things. One, it can only process roughly 5 transactions per second, which can mean that if more than 5 transactions per second are wanting to be sent through by a person or people, that they have to begin bidding against each other to put a higher price, a higher transaction fee on their payment than everyone else. And so we've seen transaction fees in Bitcoin go as high as $50 or more per transaction. And that's even if you're wanting to just send $5 worth, you still have to pay $50 worth. And then the second reason that it's become infeasible as a digital cash is that it can only clear transactions once every 10 minutes, which, you know, if you want to go buy a cup of coffee and walk out the door with it right after buying it, it's just not possible. It's just not. And so at Dash, we still see that first application of the blockchain as laid out by Satoshi Nakamoto as not having yet been reached. And that is a cash system, a money system. And so that's what we're going for. Gotcha. In the space, you'll find people going for pretty much anything else, you name it. And whether or not, to give you a prime example, there is a coin called Denta coin, and its founders believe that it will be used by dentists instead of money, that dentists aren't interested in money and rather will be interested in Denta coin. It's an interesting idea. I don't think it's going to work, but there's a lot of this kind of stuff going on.
The irony, Amanda, is that I literally was at the dentist today, and trust me, they're very interested in money because my cleaning is certainly not wasn't cheap. but I want to get to this because this is interesting, and I want to take a little bit of a derivative from this. So about 95% of what you've been communicating about, or what people hear about when they think of, as you say, cryptocurrencies or these tokens that are online, has been focused on the exchange of the value of the currency itself, and Bitcoin keeps getting lumped into that. Yet, I've actually had some good fortune and spoken to some pretty impressive executives whose episodes are going to air a little bit after yours on Thrive Loud, which talk about how they're using blockchain technology for the way their business is. Because in that double ledger entry component of the business, and I think this is what's great about it, is that there's like an ongoing general ledger that everybody has access to and everyone can visualize. Can you help communicate to the Thrive Out listeners a little bit of that building so that the level, you know, a lot of people have a feeling of, well, what is this currency or what is this value? What's the security component and the proof of transactions that's laid out in blockchain? Because I think that is something that people have myths about that they need a little clarification about.
Sure. Well, and people within the crypto space, people who are active and even substantial investors also aren't having a lot of clarity about that kind of stuff sometimes. Because what you're asking about is, can blockchain, or rather, is blockchain technology being used in business applications as a replacement for the database of old, you know, the SQL database? And I learned actually only about 3 weeks ago that the answer is yes. I met someone at a conference. She lives in England, and she and her team are using a tokenless, private and permission only blockchain to organize England's energy assets, basically. And I told her in the moment, I said, I really don't believe you that a blockchain, which I've always believed to be like this sprawling, very difficult to manage in real time thing, right? Because the people around the world running the computer programs that are required for blockchains to work, they don't know each other. But she and her company, they do it different because theirs is a permissioned network, meaning only the people within their company who they give access to, or only partner companies who they give, you know, limited access to, are able to access it. And she said, no, she said, is the blockchain that we have actually works much better for our needs than a traditional database. And that blew me right away, but it also made things make a lot of sense for me because it painted the opposite end of the spectrum. So on one end of the spectrum, you have something like Dash, which is permissionless, meaning that anybody can join our network. Anybody can download the entirety of the Dash blockchain and see every transaction that's ever taken place. And we have a token, which we are doing everything within our power to get used as a medium of exchange. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, you have a blockchain as a database, which is no token, and only permissioned actors can download it and view its contents. And so, yeah, so that is the other end of the spectrum. I don't know if Satoshi could ever have foreseen that his technology that he invented would be used in that way. And so, you know, whether or not we begin to see more of that in business applications remains to be seen. But if what she said is true, we probably will.
One of the cool businesses that you'll get to hear a future episode about this. There's a company based out in San Francisco called Upgraded, and they are a premium ticket business. So think of if you think of the ticket industry, and let's just say for argument's sake, Justin Timberlake is going to have a concert and he doesn't want to have to go through the ticket masters of the world, and he's going to have a special venue. His production company can, or the venue that they're at, can issue the tickets. And within this fiefdom of Upgraded, it's an app on the phone, people can access and purchase the tickets that way. And every time if I wanted to send Amanda B her ticket and have her give it to it, I can give it to you and there'd be a record of that. And now that ticket would actually be utilizing blockchain technology to prove, hey, it came from Justin Timberlake's production company, was bought by Lou Diamond, and then he sold it off to somebody named Amanda B. Johnson. And then she was able to use it or sell it or access it, and the security was pretty good. So in an industry that typically was dealt with paper and you know, a little, and scalpers and other people to get it in limited supply, the supply was actually being controlled by the venue and the location, which is pretty cool. So blockchain is trying to figure out ways in different industries to utilize that technology to create a great product, which is pretty cool, right? I mean, I think it's that aspect of it is clearer to me, believe it or not, than the currency and the Bitcoin situation because of its inaccessibility.
And you bring up a great point, Lou, which is that right now, these, I'll call them public blockchains, the ones that are open and viewable, like Dash and like Bitcoin, they are so difficult to use for the average person. It took me years stumbling around with this stuff, and still, sometimes I have to go online and ask someone a specific question about how to execute a specific action within my Dash wallet, because this is early level, nerdy stuff. And the only reason that we are seeing these high valuations that we're seeing, one dash sells for $700. How could that be? Well, it's because, and all of these other cryptocurrencies that you're seeing, why is the total market capitalization of the cryptocurrency space $500 billion? Well, it's because people foresee that one day it will become easier to use, and that on that day, people will prefer to use a cryptocurrency over, say, banks with dollars or banks with euros or banks with yen, because it has more desirable monetary properties. And what do I mean by that? Well, in short, the vast majority of cryptocurrencies, because they have open ledgers, they protect against what I would call secret inflation. And secret inflation is simply, I mean, if you live in the United States, I'm sure you've heard the term quantitative easing. It sounds like maybe it's cool and maybe it's awesome, but a synonym for quantitative easing would be secret inflation, which is lots of money is being created, but you don't get to know how much, and you certainly don't get to know where it's going. And that wouldn't necessarily be a problem if secret inflation didn't have this nasty habit of devaluing the currency. And so the people investing in these cryptocurrencies like Dash right now are not doing so because it's super awesome and easy to use today, but rather because they believe that if and when it becomes so, the vast majority of people in this world will so overwhelmingly prefer the monetary policy of something like Dash versus the monetary policies of old.
Let me ask this question, Amanda. Is this true or false? There is a limited amount of Bitcoins in the world.
Yes, anyone who wants to see the number of coins of any of these cryptocurrencies can visit a website like coinmarketcap.com, and you can see down to the last token how many tokens each of these blockchains tracks and has on its double entry accounted ledger.
So this is one of those things, by the way, when you're talking about people are buying and the value skyrocketing, the old Wall Street rumor was, you know, you buy the rumor and you sell the news. And obviously we're in the stage of what this potentially can be and the rumors of where things are going and what potentially can be in the currencies. And the minute that obviously this stuff actually becomes real and transactional, those values might have peaked out. But with a limited supply of how many of these Bitcoins are out there or cryptocurrencies that are in each one of these buckets that are there, there is this point of, you know, there's only a limited supplies. And if it does become that high-end currency, the values will go through the roof because it might be the way that we transact in the future. Talk to us a little bit about how can they regulate any of this stuff, since currencies are very highly regulated in many different countries and in Federal Reserve banks and all of that. You know, what's the situation on regulation around cryptocurrency?
Sure. So the interesting thing is that when we talk about regulations, we see that most of the time regulations are, of course, country specific. And the very interesting thing about countries is that quite nearly all of them have their own currency. And so in a way, it's almost like regulation and currency go hand in hand. And we see that that is definitely true with cryptocurrencies, in that each of them is regulated or governed, so to speak, by the people running the software for that given blockchain and its token. So we say things like there can only be a limited supply that's pre-programmed into each of these currencies, which for some of them is true, Dash included and Bitcoin included. But the very interesting thing is that because these blockchain-based tokens rely on code, and the code is open source, and any and all code could be edited, could be changed, The people running the networks, and when I say running the networks, I mean actually they have computers either at their home or hosted in a data center that has a copy of the blockchain, and they talk to everyone else in the world who also has a computer that has a copy of the blockchain. If a majority of them, that is, you know, 51%, were to decide to change the code that they are running, they could change anything about a coin, including its supply cap. And so as more people begin to realize that these different cryptocurrencies regulate themselves by the choices that the humans running them make, they'll begin to see that what the market is really offering them is varying levels of trust. And currency, at the end of the day, is all about trust. There's no reason to work for dollars today if you don't trust that the Federal Reserve will more or less maintain those same dollars' values by tomorrow. And so in the years to come, I believe people are going to start asking themselves, you know, which of these cryptocurrency networks do I trust? Because this, they're asking for my wealth. They're asking for the honor and the responsibility and the privilege of managing the value of my wealth. Which of them actually deserves that honor and privilege? And that's actually, I think, how regulations will take form, in that consumers will vote with their wealth whose policies and regulations they approve of, and hence will it become more mainstream.
Amanda, which will be the bigger topic over the next 5 years, in your opinion? The discussion and the value of cryptocurrency, or how blockchain technology is being used in so many different ways to replace database, the way we think about database and data across businesses around the globe?
Well, if I had to guess, I would say the former, if no other reason than money is more exciting than databases. And there's a second reason, which is that should blockchains come to replace traditional databases within the business models of more and more businesses, I just don't think that it would be super newsworthy. Like, for example, if Amazon were to change something in its back end of how it runs its business, you know, that may make it into a few tech publications, and people deep into, you know, back end development may find it interesting. But I wouldn't see something like that being headline news.
Very good. Let's dive a little bit into you. So this is a pretty cool spot that you're in. This is an unbelievably hot topic. You speak everywhere around this, and obviously speaking on behalf of Dash's digital currency. From you personally, are you enjoying this ride? And would you have ever have thought from that first time that you started to do some research on this, this is where you'd be?
Probably not. I remember feeling really out of my element when I first started. I'll tell you where I first started. I'm sure that I went to a web search and typed in something like, what is Bitcoin? And I think one of the first things that came up was a educational video series produced by Khan Academy. And so I thought, shoot, Khan Academy, they have a great reputation. I'll give this a go. And as I'm watching their video series, I'm hearing all of these words I've never heard before. I'm hearing the word cryptography and hash function and mining and all of these things. And it was like just being dipped into this vat of foreign strangeness. And I may never have picked it up again if, again, Jeffrey Tucker, the man I mentioned before who had sent me some cryptocurrency for the first time, he calls me again in all of a flush and a dizzy and says, I'm going to present about Bitcoin at Freedom Fest in Las Vegas in a few months, and you're going to speak on the panel with me. And really, that's how much, you know, wild, blind faith he placed in me. And so to not let him down and to not embarrass myself, I just forced myself to get more acquainted with all of these horrible new terms like cryptography and mining and all of these horrible things. And as I did so, I broke through a glass ceiling that I didn't know that I had, or rather, I did know that I had, in that I I was never into computers. I would never have considered myself tech savvy. I would never have considered myself finance savvy. And these are the reasons, I believe, why I'm hired to do the job that I do, which is that I really am, my background really is very average and non-specialized. I really am just an average Joe who just so happened to get, you know, kind of pressured into learning about something. And after I broke through the glass ceiling and found a little bit of confidence and interest, I went really deep and started having a lot of fun.
So in this period when you're having a lot of fun, and there's, I know you're doing a lot of work and you're doing a lot of communication, one of the questions I ask all the Thrive Loud guests is, when you have trouble thriving, who do you turn to personally to get back on the thriving track, to get on your A game, if you would?
That's a great question. And that is a lesson that I actually had to come to just over this past year. About 8 months ago, I hit what I would call a plateau in what I was doing at the time. At the time, I was making a weekly video about Dash, and my content started to stagnate, and my view counts started to stagnate, and I just felt stuck and lost, and like I was not able to contribute any more than what I had already contributed. And so I asked the Dash Network, my employers, for a break, basically, for a hiatus. And I wasn't sure if I would ever seek employment from Dash or not again. And my hiatus in the first, second, third, and fourth month was just kind of actually looking inward, and not for answers or anything in particularly inspiring, but rather just quietude. As you know, new agey and as embarrassing as it might sound, I just started doing yoga every day and just sitting by myself and writing things down and deep breathing, to, you know, quell sort of anxiety and that sort of thing. And by about the fourth month, I realized I'm never not going to be able to think about Dash every day, because I had been those 4 months prior. I was still checking cryptocurrency headlines and Dash in particular every day, because I really am that interested in it. And I'm just like anyone else in that I require some inputs in life to feel like I've contributed to the community, that I am in some way important and valued by someone somewhere. And of course, I get that feeling is fulfilled for me in working for Dash. And I mean, I know that I have a service that I can offer them. And so I went back to them after a 6 month hiatus. And I said, I feel good. I feel better. I feel like I would like to contribute for you again. Here's the ideas I've been percolating on. Here's how I think I can take things to the next level. Would you have me back? And, you know, thank the heavens they did. And so I am now at a place where I'm doing both. I am working for Dash, which brings me the fulfillment that I am contributing and I am valuable. But I have stuck with my yoga and my meditation and my quiet minutes and hours to keep me sane.
It's awesome. And it's a great question. And this will lead towards, as we start to wrap up here, Amanda, tell us, what's next for you specifically with this? I mean, obviously this is growing and you're doing all this stuff with Dash. Where are some of the big dreams, what I like to say, those BHAGs, if you were, those big, hairy, audacious goals that you're seeking personally to achieve, whether it's in writing, communication, where do you see the big picture for you?
Sure. Well, the big picture for me is to remain on the train and ideally be a part of the BHAG that the Dash Network has as a whole, which is to get the heck out of this "it's so hard to use our product" space, because that's not something that we can sell or in the long term, meaning We can't continue to say, oh, well, you know, one day this is going to be money if we have no reason to say that. And so Dash is in a very unique position in that we are actually the only top cryptocurrency I know of who is currently formulating a way to remove the visual elements of cryptography from the experience of using our product. So if any of your listeners have never opened a cryptocurrency wallet, I would encourage them to do so so that they can get a visual reference of what I'm saying. I would recommend the Jax blockchain wallet. It's available on all types of mobile app stores. It's called the Jax blockchain wallet. Install it. Tell it you want it to support Dash if you like. And when the wallet comes up, take a look at that long, horrible string of numbers and letters and realize that that is your payment address. And what's more, there's an even longer string of numbers and letters that correspond to it that you have to learn to manage in order to keep control of your funds. And all of these things are the main reason why nearly everyone that I talk to keeps their coins on exchanges, which is so dangerous because exchanges are getting hacked frequently. There was a $500 million exchange hack last week. And these are going to keep happening and keep happening because we are in the wild west of cryptocurrency. And so Dash is releasing this year a product which will remove the appearance of these horrible, unmanageable addresses and replace it with a simple username, just like the way you use PayPal or just like the way you use Venmo. And we are going to keep making releases such as that so that people can feel comfortable and familiar enough with the product to take their Dash off exchanges for heaven's sake and possess it themselves on their phone. And that is when we can usher in Satoshi Nakamoto's real promise of everyone's ability to be their own bank if they want to.
I like it. And I think you, in that one last sentence there, you summarized all the potential, the fear, the scariness, and where it can all head to at the same time. So a nice job there. You should have your own podcast show, Amanda. So with this, I wanted to ask, give us all the plugs on where everyone can learn specifically about you, learn about Dash. And this is your chance to just give everyone the places that they can share and educate themselves.
Sure. Well, I'd love for a follow on Twitter from any and all of your listeners. I'm AmandaB_Johnson on Twitter. And then you can find out more about Dash actually by our YouTube channel, where I've contributed quite a bit. If you just go to youtube.com/dash.org, we have lots and lots of stuff prepared for you there. And then if you are feeling a wild hair and you'd like to download a Dash wallet, which I do recommend, there is the Jax blockchain wallet, like I recommended before, or if you'd like to dig real down deep because you're a techie kind of guy or gal, I'd recommend downloading our core wallet, which has all the functionalities that we offer from dash.org/wallets.
Amanda B. Johnson, your all-time favorite movie?
The Big Short.
Somehow that didn't surprise me. But what specifically did you like about that movie?
I liked that they made something that's usually as yucky and boring and, you know, elitist looking as high finance. They made it completely understandable. And what's more, they made it funny and sexy.
Yeah. And I think that's what the whole world is looking for with anything that comes new when it's complicated is, like you said, hopefully companies like yours, Dash, help to make things a little bit more clear and simple, but also safe. And, that movie, by the way, you can't get enough of it. I unfortunately lived it, having worked on Wall Street and get to see all that stuff. So to watch that movie was a little frustrating, but on the same sense, I will tell you, it did a great job of really helping to paint the picture of what was going on. And, that is something that Michael Lewis does very well in all of his books. I'm sure he's already on this brigade. I actually heard that there is a cryptocurrency related thing in his, arsenal that he's talking about now. So stay tuned. Amanda B. Johnson, thank you so much for coming on Thrive Loud. And thank you for giving the time to educate the Thrive Loud listeners, because that was definitely helpful for them. And I know this only because people are like, if you're going to get somebody on blockchain or cryptocurrencies, please have them explain what it all is. So thank you for taking the time to do that.
Thank you for the invite, Lou.
Okay. And Amanda B. Johnson, thank you for being on Thrive Loud. And to all the Thrive Loud listeners out there, keep thriving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Make sure to subscribe on iTunes, Overcast, or wherever you get your podcasts. And follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Thrive Loud. Or find us on the web at thriveloud.com.